Well, I want to thank the panel members, all of them. We heard different perspectives. I think one thing that we learned from everybody is that security is not only a matter of security services, that it has to look at the large context, and even security services, be they police or internal security or foreign security or armies, have to take into account cultural context, political context, in order to do their work effectively. I think that since we're running late and we're all thinking about lunch, what we're going to do is, which is also a matter of security, what we're going to do is we're going to take two or three questions. I'm going to start with the back this time. So anybody who is interested, and we're not going to talk about secret societies, so you're going to have to ask another, you're going to have to ask a question, and you're going to talk about something different, please. Okay, go ahead, but short and sweet.
Yes, sir. I completely agree with with all the speakers, especially the last one, and I think it's basically a subject of general justice and general equality and absence of racism, supremacism, and all those isms that shouldn't exist.
Okay.
Oh, yeah, I needed to make a question.
Please.
I wonder, let me see my papers, if, yes, safety could, for the sake of safety, we could run into an Orwellian war claimed by George Bush Sr., asking for a new world order, and which meant a one world government by a supremacist, self-claimed new aristocracy.
Okay, we'll get one or two more questions, and then we'll the panel can ask. Okay, yes, please.
Hey, thank you. I'm a little bit nervous, so sorry.
It's all right.
It has been a pleasure to hear you all, especially Marianne, you are my professional example. Sorry. My question is, you have talked about political and government management, about media, especially Luis Fraga. Gabriel Jacobs talked about a more understanding between countries. Antonio Rebelo de Sousa talked about the economy, and each economy is a different case to be considered. So do you think, on basis of what you said and what we heard, that it would be more effective to create a global strategy for human safety, or a national strategy with a global supervision and like sharing experience between countries?
Okay, and one more question at this point, maybe two. Anybody in the back? So please, over here.
Thank you so much. My question is for Mariana. I'm here. Okay. Mariana, I was thrilled with your enthusiasm, and I think that's really important. But my question is very simple. What you suggested, of course, makes sense. It's very, very reasonable. But for that to happen, you had to be sure that 100% of the people would agree with that. And do you think that's possible? Because our world, our humanity, it's so plural, so different. Thank you.
Okay, any questions from up front besides that? Oh, up there. Okay, one more question and that'll be it.
Okay, thank you. I hope this doesn't belong in the secret societies, but I was wondering if any of the panel members have an opinion on WikiLeaks and how the national security, personal security, and information all should be valued, and for example, in the case of WikiLeaks, how we should act on this.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Good question. What I suggest is the following. We'll go in reverse order, and each member of the panel will have a minute or two to answer any question that he wants or she wants, and to relate to the other panelists. So, Mariana.
Can I answer first?
Sure.
The reason I said it was not fair that she was asking the question is because she's a former professor of mine at university. And when I saw her outside, she's super smart. And I said, do not ask me any questions. It's not fair. But yes, it's an easy answer to a very complicated problem. I know that. But I think the only way that we can start a discussion is by starting with easy answers. But I would like to also start by saying that I'm not here to come up with solutions. Again, I'm not an academic, I'm a journalist. My role here is to try to figure out what's happening, what is wrong, and try to diagnose the symptoms. But I do believe that we should start somewhere, and simple answers seem to me like the best place to start.
Antonio?
I would like to answer to two questions. The first question concerns the necessity of a plan for each economy and a global plan and a global strategy. Of course, I think that each economy should have a strategy, a strategic plan, and a strategy. And I think that, but it is also necessary to have a global strategy, a regional strategy, because as you know, we live in an open economy, and for instance, Portugal, we are a small open economy. We cannot solve by ourselves all the problems. Everybody knows that. So, but I think I'm in favor of a strategy and that for our internationalization, for our development. We should have a development model, and we don't have up to now. And we should have regional plans, we should have a national plan, we should know what are the strategic sectors in our economy so that we could have afterwards a policy with the incentives for the investment in those strategic sectors. Otherwise, it will be impossible. The other question concerning a model for the global community and having someone trying to impose a model to the other countries, of course, I'm not in favor of that, but I don't have guilty complex. I don't have guilty complex. I think that there are some principles that we, as Democrats in Western world, should not discuss. The Declaration of Human Rights, the freedom of expression, equal rights for men and women, this kind of questions, we should not raise them. And so I'm not available to discuss with anyone these principles. If you call that to try to impose these principles to other civilizations, you can call it. But in my opinion, I think that Western democracies should not be available to discuss some of them principles that have to do with some of the French, with the French Revolution principles and with the Declaration of Principles in the United States, the Declaration of Independence. These principles that are really very important in terms of human rights, they are part of a paradigm that is it is up to a certain extent already accepted by the international community. You don't see any president or any prime minister of any country going to the United Nations and say that he's against the freedom of speech or saying that he's against elections. Even those that are against that, they say that they are trying their best to put in practice these principles in their own countries. So this means that there are certain principles and certain values that we should not be ashamed of.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Helena.
Well, I will take this opportunity just to say that the panel was about human security and not about state security. And here we have a very big difference. Before the Cold War, the end of the Cold War, we talked in international relations about state security. So we were afraid of other states. After the end of the Cold War, we began to talk about human security. So it is a broader sense of security. Security, it's economical security. It's security to have food to eat, as Mariana was describing. And the other impact of this notion is that security is not only a thing for professionals. Security is something for everybody. Each of us has duties on security. Security is global. Security must be inclusive. And if we spend too much money on wrong things, it's sometimes because we don't prepare well for what is called high impact, low probability in events. Or in the contrary, we prepare too much for such an event and not for the others. And our feeling of insecurity, it's completely different of the reality of security. For instance, if I ask you, what are you afraid of? And I ask that myself, you are not afraid of a bomb now, here, or a terrorist attack. It can happen, of course. But we perhaps are more afraid of other kind of things, like to be robbed or something. Usually, we are afraid of things that we cannot control. We are afraid of things that we don't know. So we are afraid of the unknown. So security is also about knowledge, to know better the things, to study, to educate ourselves. Thank you.
Thank you. Gabriela.
Yeah, thank you. I would like to refer first to a question that was about local solutions versus global strategies. Yes, I absolutely believe we need local solutions to security. We need to use our local expertise, our local knowledge, our cultural expertise, because security solutions only make sense in the very specific environment they need to apply to, and we have to be very careful, and we know from many examples that we can't impose solutions from one context into another. But I also think that we really have to overcome our local and overly national focus on security questions. We had many examples, and Mariana also gave a very good one. Things that are happening at the other side of the world, of course, are of our concern. The other issue I wanted to comment on, I'm a big fan of easy answers to complex questions. And I am increasingly surprised and really also concerned why we don't have a bigger public debate about many, many, many technological solutions or other security solutions. I'm really concerned why it is possible that in our campaigns, political campaigns, the security issue is so important. How is it possible that politicians can promise that we live in a safe world? It's crazy. Of course, life is unsafe. We have to accept this. And this is a bias that I'm worried about. And when we hear stories from the police, for example, in the Netherlands, the police installed camera surveillance in one of the big student cities in Utrecht, and they prepared themselves for a big public debate. They brought lawyers in, they informed the media, they had prepared a big evening because they thought there will be really riot against us. Three people came, and all three people were asking if the camera could be installed in front of their house because they want to have more surveillance. And it is, to me, surprising that we hear more, I would say, classic left arguments from the police who say, why do you allow us? Why do you don't hold us back because we don't need all this information? Why is this such a fear-oriented debate? We discussed Islamophobia yesterday. There are many examples in this direction. Where I would, yeah, to say it again, I am a fan of easy answers to these questions. And just a very simple remark of saying, shouldn't we invest this money into schooling, into social programs, instead into camera surveillance, to give a very simple example.
Yeah. Thank you. Luis.
Thank you, moderator. I'm going to react on two on the issues that were raised. First, if a national security or a global security is needed, and while I do agree with my predecessors speaking that, of course, both are compatible. But the point is that whereas there are strong and well-designed national securities, well-designed depending on the country, there's not such a global strategy to approach these subjects. Why? Because there's not a global institution. And is going to exist, this global institution? The answer, we won't have it in 20 years. The point is that if UN is failing to create such a global strategy, point number one, except for a few issues, which are important. I mean, the national food, the UN food program of the UN is working very well, and it could be said the same about a few programs. However, there are issues which require a transnational global solution. One of them, and we didn't speak about that today, is the drugs. There's a big debate right now in many countries about some people call it decriminalization, some people call it delegalization, and they're totally legalization, and they're different concepts. But that's on the table. I mean, I've been speaking about two conflicts, Colombia and Guatemala, which the origin of those conflicts, same could be said, by the way, about Afghanistan, but it's totally different. They're totally different conflicts. But in these conflicts, both the president of Guatemala and he's a general. I mean, he's a general, supposed to be a man of order. And he is claiming for a decriminalization of drugs, and same could be said about Santos. So, but of course, if they do it in one country and another country, nothing's going to happen. We require a global strategy for that, one point. Second point, I'm also going to react on what was said on the media. I think it's important that the media are conscious about their responsibility. If some of us knows an issue, how it was, and reads what was in the press or in the newspaper or in the TV, people who are real experts on the issue, they say, well, that's not like that. And if this happens to you many times and you see what they've written, well, that's a lie. How can they say that? But of course, at the very end, you read it just to read what the people are reading. But we are in a problem now of the lack of credibility, not only of politicians, but also from the press. Why? I think it was said today that we are in a transitory period. Many things are changing, and we come from a time where the values were clear. Now, these values are not more any more valuable or in strength. Some of them yes, some of them no. And the new values are still not there. That's why the disorientation of our times. But I'm optimistic. I think in 100, maybe 50, let's think that 10 years, we are going to be in a more clear and, of course, better world.
Thank you. Does anybody want to say anything about WikiLeaks? WikiLeaks, the question was asked.
Can I just say one last thing? That the whole panel we're talking about human security. It's really interesting though that we are living, and this is something that was passed along to me the other day that I thought was really interesting. We are living actually in the safest time in history. I don't think many people know that. And partly, I mean, the statistics are actually staggering. In the hunter-gathering ages, which is just a few years ago, about 60% of people were killed because of violence from another human being. Nowadays, it's 0.00 something are killed because of wars or crime. It's really amazing, and partly is because the media are doing their job. And the reason why there's a perception that there is more violence nowadays is because the media are doing their job. And there are places like National Geographic who are going around the world telling these stories of these conflicts happening around the world. But there's also an idea, and it's the whole idea behind the perception, is that we are always more afraid of things that we see in the newspaper. Usually I say, if you see it in the newspaper, you don't need to be afraid of it, because it's very likely it's not gonna happen, because it's an anomaly, right? So I just want you to all know that we are living in a very safe world, even though we all have the perception that we don't. Thank you.
The last point is an interesting one, and perhaps we can talk about it over lunch. I'm not as completely as optimistic as you are, maybe because I live somewhere else. But first of all, with regard to WikiLeaks, I'll just make a very short comment we heard earlier this morning about transparency. There's no doubt on the one hand that we're living in a more transparent world, and this will affect companies and individuals who enjoy power, be it in the commercial world, the business world, or in the world of government. That being said, I have no doubt that the one reaction will be that people will be more circumspect and will take new security measures. So it's an interesting dynamic. And two, we heard about Nigeria. We heard about terrible conditions there. I've mentioned it, the business of what happened in Bangladesh. This is also a matter of consumers. When consumers stop putting up with this, then things will begin to change in the West, in our countries, whether it's Portugal or the rest of Europe or Israel or North America or South America. When consumers say enough, then things will begin to change. So without further ado, I'd like to invite our host back. The session is finished. I have 10 minutes more. How do you like that? Okay, so we have room for two more questions. So one, two, okay. Yes, please.
Luis Fraga, in terms of security, don't you think that the press and the television, in terms of sensationalism, in terms of the terrorism, if, like with the ETA in Spain, you made an agreement with journalists and television that they wouldn't show any more bombings, the bombings didn't disappear, but terrorism came down to a level. So as you say, we have to go towards a new world, and the press has to be responsible. But the press can only be responsible if then the ratings don't count. The ratings, that's where the whole television aspect of it has to come out of it, because of course sensationalism plays a role. As sensationalism plays a role, money plays a role. But I believe that the security that we're talking about, first of all, the press has to be responsible and not talk about terrorism and not give them antenna and not give them time, because if they wouldn't have time, there would be no terrorism.
Okay, thank you very much. Okay, one second, yeah.
Well, I totally agree with you in that issue. I think this is one of the strategies that has been spoken a lot in when fighting terrorism, that we don't speak about that. The problem is that, of course, they have to inform. But the problem is not only that they speak about terrorism, that they help the terrorism to succeed in their objectives. The problem is when there's a lie, and that's one degree of the problem. The other degree of the problem is when it's an intentioned lie which obeys to a strategy. For example, I put you the example of when I've seen in certain press that these Basque terrorists are freedom fighters. That's a lie. Or if some terrorists in other countries are called freedom fighters, that's a lie. But the problem is when this lie is according to a strategy.
Go ahead. Go.
I fully agree to what you said, and the more I'm working with police, the more I also get critical about the role of media. But I also have to say, we are living in a time of social media. So we are living in a time where we are not fully dependent on official journalism, on official media. So I also think that, and coming back to the example of WikiLeaks, which is certainly an extreme example there, we have, as a public, much more possibilities than we ever had to control law enforcement, to contribute to politics in completely free and the most basic democratic ways we can imagine. So when we don't like journalists and when we are not happy with what is officially communicated, I think there should be, and I trust that there will be, and we see already many examples, a much bigger use of all the communication possibilities we have. I mean, we call this intelligence crowdsourcing and co-creation, and there are many concepts that show that social media provide a way of using the intelligence worldwide of all kind of people.
Thank you. And Mariana?
As a journalist, I think I have to say something here. I think that pretending that terrorism doesn't happen is not going to solve the problem, obviously. Mm-hmm. I think that it's our job as media is to find out why it's happening. And I had the chance back in 2003 with the start of the Iraq War. I was living in Syria at the time. And I went to the right out the border in the north of Iraq, Syria, between Syria and Iraq. And I had the chance to spend a lot of time there speaking to people who were crossing the border into Iraq to basically fight against the invasion and kill Americans. And of course, I did not agree with what they stood for or with their worldview, but I thought it was important to be able to show the world why they were doing what they were doing. And I think if the people like them were heard more, then maybe we could start addressing the roots of the problem instead of pretending that they don't exist.
Okay, one after the other.
After you.
Well, thank you very much for the commentary. I can say I agree, not disagreeing with Mariana, because I remember the words of the Iranian Shirin Ebadi that was here, and I think you heard. And she told, don't let Iran use your satellites to spread their TV. And this was a way how she spread their message. And she told us, journalists are the best friends of activists. And journalists are friends of each one that can use or want to use the journalist. It's a media. The question here is to educate. Sometimes journalists, they are very idealistic persons. They fight for several human rights, and they do their job the best way. So one of our responsibilities, the others, is to help them to do their job in the best way. Terrorism is a good example. I assisted the last terrible Boston bombings, and I realized the difference between the cover of the press between these bombings in this year and 2001 in the United States. Not to compare with other countries, because it's completely different the way how the media covered this kind of incidents. What I observed was well-educated media in this time. So they didn't told anything that they didn't realize it was proved or given by the law enforcement. They were cautious. They have learned. They are not afraid to commit errors. It's not like here in Portugal, because here, if we commit an error, it is a big disgrace for our life. Other cultures invest on this. Okay, it's human, we can commit errors, but we can learn with our errors. So that's why we have the so-called lessons learned. And we may apply those lessons learned everywhere. Thank you for your commentary.
Antonio?
I just wanted to say something about the media and the terrorism. We must think that there are different kinds of terrorism. In some cases, as for instance with ETA for a long time, it was with an individual purpose. So, there was the purpose of killing a prime minister or of killing a minister, a general or something like that, someone like that. And but then with the IRA, for instance, there was a different purpose, which was to have what they call global terrorism and putting the population against the government because, well, thousands of people could die with a bomb. It's a different kind of terrorism. And, of course, I'm not in favor of giving time in the media to the terrorism, but people must be, and certain images can be avoided. But at the same time, it's necessary to inform people because it's, people must understand why the governments, the democratic governments, have to react and why they should have the means that are really necessary to react and to fight against terrorism. And people would not understand if they are not informed about the danger of terrorism. So it's very important to have here a balanced position, a certain equilibrium. It's necessary to inform so that people can support the measures that are necessary from the government, but of course, it's also necessary not to give too much time to terrorism in the media.
Okay. One more question, please.
Thank you for your comments and remarks. I like a lot how you describe peace and human security. I guess this is because you had the first hand like knowledge you have seen with yourself. Actually, I would like to ask Professor Robin because he's the maybe the only one that he is living now in a conflict area.
Two of us.
What's your definition for human security and peace? I mean, for Mariana, she said for us peace wouldn't be possible without having an access to resources to have a dignified life, also to be free from fear and want. So I would like to hear it from you as somebody who's living
Thank
in a
you.
Conflict.
So thank you very much for the opportunity. that we don't have much time, but I will just say very briefly, there are many of us in Israel, and I count myself among them, who believe firmly in a historical reconciliation between the Israeli Jews and the Palestinian people based on mutual recognition. Reconciliation, negotiations, compromise, historical compromise between the two peoples, a two-state solution in, we can call it Palestine, we can call it the land of Israel, we can call it the Holy Land, and I think it's we still have a way off in the future. The political authorities on both sides often do things which do not further that, but I believe in the long run that the historical interests of both sides is in reconciliation and compromise and mutual recognition. Thank you. On that note, that's obviously ties in very well with our panel, and it probably deserves at least more than a panel. Perhaps we can devote the whole next conference in 2 years to the conflicts on the Eastern Mediterranean. Anyway, I think that we can conclude and invite our host back. Thank you.